From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Clinical Reviews, interviews and ideas about innovations in medicine, science, and clinical practice.
Welcome to our listeners from around the world, and thank you for tuning in to this JAMA Clinical Reviews podcast. I am your host, Mary McDermott, Deputy Editor of JAMA, and I'm here today with Dr. Behnoud Begdelli, who is Assistant Professor at Harvard Medical School and Cardiologist at Brigham and Women's Hospital in Boston. He is author of a JAMA review on the topic of superficial venous thrombosis. Welcome, Dr. Begdelli.
Thank you so much, Dr. McDermott. It's great to be with you.
Thank you. Could you just tell us what is superficial venous thrombosis and how common is it?
So superficial vein thrombosis happens when there is a thrombus, a clot, within the superficial veins in the body. And the reason it's important is twofold. Number one, it causes local symptoms and discomfort for the patient, but also it might be a marker of risk for something more serious and recurrent thromboembolic events.
And can you tell us what the typical signs and symptoms of superficial vein thrombosis are?
Absolutely. So typically it starts with pain and local and duration discomfort, and sometimes even a palpable cord in the region. And if it's in the upper extremities, most often it's in the context of having had prior intravenous catheters or other forms of vascular instrumentation. In the lower extremities, most often we get to see that in people who've had either venous varicosities or superficial venous incompetence.
And for the upper extremity, your review does discuss that association with intravenous catheters. Are there certain intravenous catheters that are associated with a higher risk of superficial vein thrombosis?
Yes, of course. And thank you so much for pointing out to that. In terms of the material for the catheter, the epidemiological studies that we've seen do not show a clear distinction. However, there are a couple of other things that are important. One that makes a lot of clinical sense. The larger the diameter of the catheter, the more likely it is that there would be a risk for superficial vein thrombosis, in part because it's partially obstructing the venous flow, hence the excess risk. And the other thing to consider is, again, if it's really a long catheter, again, there could be more likelihood for damage to the endothelium, thereby a risk for superficial vein thrombosis.
So to prevent the superficial vein thrombosis in the upper extremity, you'd want to select a shorter and smaller caliber catheter.
Exactly.
And let's talk about lower extremity superficial vein thrombosis. What is the most common location for lower extremity superficial vein thrombosis?
Absolutely. So in the lower extremity, the greater and smaller saphenous vein are really the most important places. So great saphenous vein accounts for greater than 70% of patients with lower extremity superficial vein thrombosis, and between 20 to 25% of people have small saphenous vein involved. So those are the two most important.
And your review talks about how sometimes superficial vein thrombosis can become deep vein thrombosis. And so one of the cornerstones of management is making sure that the superficial thrombosis doesn't become deep. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Most certainly. And this is one of the most important reasons that we choose to treat some of the patients with superficial vein thrombosis. These veins typically connect through major venous junctions, such as the saphenofemoral, to the deeper venous system. And the concern is, if the thrombus were to propagate, even occasionally, even if it gets closer to the junction, we get to treat them as if it's a DVT. And of course, it's obvious why we treat DVT, because ultimately there is a risk of pulmonary embolism. So there is a local risk with symptoms and deterioration, but more importantly, there is a systemic risk of thrombus propagation and ultimately a risk of pulmonary embolism, which we are trying to avoid.
Right. And so the superficial vein thrombosis itself wouldn't typically propagate, but if it becomes deep, obviously there is that risk. Is that correct?
Exactly. Absolutely.
Okay. And then there are some criteria that you talk about in the review for some superficial vein thromboses that are perhaps more likely to become deep. And can you tell us about that?
For sure. And I think I have to preface that with the fact that we would love to see larger and better quality studies to help inform us provide better care for patients. But until then, based off of the existing evidence, I think there is consensus that if the thrombus is within 3 centimeters or closer to the deep venous junctions, it's reasonable to treat them with therapeutic intensity anticoagulation because they confer a greater risk. Now, aside from that, meaning if they're farther away from those deep vein confluences, if the thrombus is 5 centimeters or greater in length, it is still considered reasonable to consider anticoagulation. But in this case, it would be a lower intensity. And most often we choose fondaparinux because it has the best evidence available, with alternatives being rivaroxaban and low molecular weight heparins, which we can talk about in a minute. But assuming that the thrombus is not closer than 3 centimeters to the deep venous junction, and that the length is not greater than 5 centimeters, many of these cases can be managed conservatively just with warm compress, NSAIDs, and other conservative measures, and monitored for a few days. And if the symptoms improve, there is no necessity for systemic anticoagulation unless the symptoms persist or deteriorate.
Okay. So I want to talk to you about the use of Doppler ultrasound to diagnose and evaluate the risk of becoming a deep venous thrombosis. So given what you just told us, does this mean that everybody who may have a superficial vein thrombosis of the lower extremity should have imaging with ultrasound to find out where the thrombus is and how long it is?
This is such an important point. So I'll pivot back for a second to blood markers and then come back to the imaging. In diagnosis of DVT and PE, we often use D-dimer. Here, there is not a lot of place for that, in part because the sensitivity is not really good. And in terms of ultrasound, the good thing is it has a very good positive predictive value and it's very sensitive. So from a diagnostic perspective, it's a very good tool. However, we do not routinely recommend it for everyone, reason being, in many cases, the symptoms and signs are so classic that it kind of obviates the need to do an ultrasound. But if there is ever concern for the diagnosis, meaning we have multiple other things in the differential, such as cellulitis, among others, or there is concern for thrombus progression toward the deeper veins, it's always reasonable to consider ultrasound.
Okay. But I guess my question is, even if clinically it seems clear that this is a superficial vein thrombosis, don't you need to find out whether it's close to the deep system and how long it is in order to select treatment?
That's a great question. And clinically speaking, I think it depends on the context. For example, if it's really in a distal superficial vein close to a catheter, and many of us as clinicians run into that, I think it would be a bit excessive to do an ultrasound for each and every patient with that. However, if there is that concern, as you say, and it's a bigger superficial vein and there is a large area of induration, I think it makes a lot of sense and it's a non-invasive test which may inform our management. So it's reasonable, even if I don't think it's necessary for every single individual.
Okay. So two more questions about the ultrasound. One is, if you do the ultrasound and you establish that the vein thrombosis either does meet the criteria or doesn't, is it ever appropriate or necessary to do a follow-up ultrasound?
That's another excellent question. And I think even for the bigger sibling in the condition, which is DVT, there are no established criteria to necessarily do follow-up studies with ultrasound. Barring any change in symptoms, I think for the most part, we are treating to some extent to alleviate symptoms. And second would be whether or not there are major enduring risk factors that warrant a longer duration of anticoagulation. One thing for which we don't have a lot of data, but I think in select cases could be considered, for example, is the duration of treatment in patients with active cancer. I don't personally see it different from DVTs and PEs with active cancer, but because there are no hard evidence, we didn't get into that deeply in the review itself.
So do you ever perform a follow-up ultrasound for superficial?
Not routinely, unless there is clinical indication, there are symptoms of deterioration, or there is another concerning feature that warrants further follow-up. But for the superficial vein thrombosis per se, I do not.
Thank you. And then Can you also, can we go back to upper extremity for a moment? And do those ever become deep in the upper extremity?
They occasionally do, and they are associated with a lot of local discomfort. And the reason upper extremity DVT is very important to manage, they do carry overall a lower risk of pulmonary embolism based off of population-based studies. However, the local symptoms and post-thrombotic syndrome in the upper extremities could be even more debilitating. So it's very important for us to try to prevent that from happening.
Okay. Let's talk about treatment. Can you just give us an overview? You did allude already to first-line treatment being warm compresses and non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. Presumably any non-steroidal will do?
There were a couple of randomized trials on the smaller side with agents that are not available in the United States. So here, for the agents that we have available, the common ones that are being used by clinicians include naproxen, ibuprofen, and even higher doses of aspirin. But there are no head-to-head comparisons for non-inferiority or superiority among them. But NSAIDs are very reasonable, and so is warm compress. And then for the subset of patients that are appropriate, systemic anticoagulation that we briefly talked and we can discuss a little more.
Okay. And for the warm compresses and non-steroidals, that's just for symptoms, right? It's not actually helping anything else.
That's true. Again, to some extent, I'm going off of the PE studies in the past. There might be evidence that NSAIDs have some treatment effect for reducing the size of thrombi themselves, but specific to superficial vein thrombosis, we do not have firm evidence to prove that. The small clinical trial that was performed was pretty inconclusive.
Yes. Can you talk through when you select anticoagulation with fondaparinol or rivaroxaban or others?
Absolutely. So I think there are a few important considerations. The most important one in my mind is how close the superficial vein thrombus is toward the deep venous system. As we discussed, if it's within 3 centimeters proximity to the deep veins, I would consider them kind of as DVT equivalent. I would treat them with systemic anticoagulation as if we are dealing with a DVT, because based off of some epidemiological investigations, the risk of developing a DVT from these is relatively high. So we have to treat aggressively to minimize the risk of those becoming a DVT. So that's one. And then the second thing is, if they're farther away from the deep venous system, if the thrombus is long enough, generally speaking, the studies that were conducted and the randomized trials enrolled people with thrombus length greater than 5 centimeters. So if it's greater than that, it makes sense to consider systemic anticoagulation. And in this case, if they're farther away from deep veins, but long enough, a lower intensity of systemic anticoagulation is what constitutes the preferred treatment. The best data that we have is for fondaparinux, 2.5 milligrams once daily for 6 weeks. So that would be the standard treatment. And the alternative, which is more convenient but has less robust data, is rivaroxaban 10 milligrams once daily. The third alternative, which again has limited data, would be a lower intensity of enoxaparin, such as 40 milligrams once daily.
And are the oral therapies you mentioned 6 weeks?
6 weeks, correct.
All right. And then are there any indications for anticoagulation in people who don't meet those criteria of within 3 centimeters of a deep vein or being 5 centimeters or more in length?
So barring these situations, I typically do not consider systemic anticoagulation, except for a few scenarios. For example, if some patients have multiple risk factors, if they have active cancer and they've had prior venous thromboembolic events and they have known thrombophilia, be it antiphospholipid syndrome or be it Leiden-5 mutation, et cetera, even if the data within the subset of people with superficial vein thrombosis is not completely certain, I think it's reasonable to extrapolate in those cases because the baseline risk is so high that, much like what I started with, this superficial vein thrombus event might just be a marker of risk and a future more serious thromboembolic event.
So for someone who's presenting for the first time with a superficial vein thrombosis, what kind of workup do you do to establish a potential etiology?
I think it's best for our audience first to break it down to upper extremity versus lower extremity, because in the upper extremity, in most of the cases, it's catheter associated, in which case we do not really need to do a lot more workup. The catheter should be removed soon as possible. And in most cases, we can stop the workup there and the treatment based off of what we already discussed. But for people with lower extremity superficial vein thrombosis, one of the most important things to talk about would be venous varicosities and venous reflux. So in many of those cases, in the right context, especially if they have a lot of varicosity and related history and leg swelling, I think it would be very helpful to get a venous reflux ultrasound to understand that disease, which may have potentially played a role as an underlying factor. In terms of thrombophilia workup, most of the guidelines are silent and there is really limited data to guide practice. I would do that only on a case-by-case basis, but I do not do systemic thrombophilia testing for superficial vein thrombosis in most cases.
Are you concerned about the possibility of cancer?
We should always consider it if there is an otherwise unexplained superficial vein thrombus, particularly in unusual sites. For example, some people may develop external jugular vein superficial vein thrombosis without any triggers. Those are the kind of things that trigger an alarm for me.
And is there any evidence to support long-term anticoagulation if it's an unexplained superficial vein thrombosis or not worth it?
That's a great question and one for which we do not have data to opine one way or the other. If my patient has had a history of DVT or PE and the superficial vein thrombus event is essentially a subsequent venous thrombotic event in addition to those, I tend to consider it in my overall risk assessment. But in isolation, I don't think we have enough data to recommend longitudinal treatment. The only exception, which again I consider on a case-by-case basis, is people with high-risk cancer, such as pancreatic cancer.
And then what about venous reflux? What if you do that evaluation and you find it's there? Is there anything you can do to mitigate future vein thromboses?
That's another wonderful point. Thank you so much for bringing it up. There is an ongoing clinical trial, so hopefully in a couple of years, we're going to learn more. But the consensus among the endovascular experts is that if there is venous reflux, especially in great saphenous vein or small saphenous vein, and there was a superficial vein thrombus, once the acute treatment is over and inflammation has been reduced, it is reasonable to assume that treating that venous incompetence might be associated with lower risk of local recurrence in that involved vein.
And how is that typically treated right now?
So there are a few different tools to do that. There is surgical ligation, and then there are all kinds of other endovenous interventions with thermal ablation or others.
Great. Thank you so much. This was really informative. Is there anything you'd like to add that we didn't cover?
I'm very grateful for the time, and I hope that the readership will find this piece useful.
Thank you. I'm Mary McDermott, and I've been speaking today with Dr. Benud Bigdeli, who is a cardiologist at Brigham and Women's Hospital and has a review in JAMA on the topic of superficial vein thrombosis. You can find a link to the article in this episode's description. This episode was produced by Daniel Morrow at the JAMA Network. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com or search for JAMA Network wherever you get your podcasts. Thank you for listening.
This content is protected by copyright by the American Medical Association with all rights reserved, including those for text and data mining, AI training, and similar technologies.